Okay, so let's start. The idea of today is to finish the class on random graph models. You have seen on Tuesday in some details the most simple of them, the Erdos-Reyny random graph. And today we will go a little bit faster, not in that many details, on other types of random graphs. So this is just to remind you why it's important to use random networks in network science. This was already said by Christophe. But for me, there are several good reasons. The first one is to study some properties in a control environment. Then is to compare an observed network with a randomized version. So this is very common if you want to say that we observe a certain clustering, average clustering in a network. Is it just normal or is it something exceptional? So we need to compare with a randomized version. It can be used to explain some given phenomenon. So for instance, I don't know, you want you observe that the diffusion of a virus in a population seems to have some waves. So is this something, not something that is completely normal in any random network? Or if I generate some random network with some properties, I can have this property that emerge naturally. So this can be a question why you want to have random networks to explain something. And to generate tentative data sets. So maybe you want to see the variation of this question of diffusion on networks. For instance, you launch a diffusion on a network and you want to see if every time you will have the same results or if you get different results if you try with different and how the parameters affect. So you need to test the same experiment on 100 variations. While if you have only one real network, only one population, for instance, you cannot repeat the experiment. So these are some of the reasons why random networks are really at the core of network science. And last time you saw the Erdos-Reyny random graph, so I won't go back in it, but just to remind you the important points, you have seen that if you compare the distance, the average distance in the graph between, so these are some many real networks, and if you compare the average distance computed on the network and computed on the randomized version, according to the Erdos-Reyny, you can see that they are actually pretty close from each other. They are of the same order of magnitude. So basically, in a random Erdos-Reyny random graph, you have this property of having short distances. And you have seen that for the clustering coefficient, it's different because you have in real data, you have pretty large values, while the random graph here, the clustering coefficient is much smaller in most cases. So this is what you have seen last time. So this is a key difference between a random graph and real graphs. And then you have seen this property that there is the emergence of a giant component in the network when you reach some average degree of one. So just to add to the class maybe, of Christophe, you can test this empirically. So I put a link on my slides. If you go to it, you see here some page where you can experiment it with that yourself. So you see this network and you can fix your degree and observe. So here my screen is very small, so you cannot see it clearly, but while you increase here, you see the size of the giant component and you can really see this property that here it's mostly disconnected. And then when you cross one very quickly, you get this giant component. So this website, actually, if you don't know, it's pretty nice. It's called Complexity Explorable. It's done by a researcher in network in complex systems, and he has a lot of explorable like that. So unfortunately, it does not work. I can't access to it right now. I don't know why, but it's just because of the resolution of my screen. But okay. So if you go there, you see that you have a lot of exploration on many different topics, not only networks, but there are a lot of networks in it. It can be fun to look what there is there, like the notion of filter bubble also that we will discuss in the class, or some phenomenon, yeah, echo chambers here that explain social network why people tend to be enclosed in some IDs they see only from left or for right. We'll go back to that later. But this website is pretty nice if you want to play with these IDs. Um, Okay, so this was Erdos Sreni. You have seen that we have seen that in the real network, we have these three key components. If you look at them, we see that we have a broad degree distribution in real networks. You have hubs and many nodes of small degree. You have a short path length and a large clustering coefficient. And you have seen the Erdos-Sreni random graph in which we managed to have a short path length, but we don't have the right degree distribution or the right clustering coefficient. And here we also a basic type of graphs in which you can represent, you can reproduce easily the clustering coefficient are regular lattices. So here are some examples of regular lattices. For instance, in one dimension, you put your node in a circle or on a line, and you connect to the closest neighbors. So for example, the four closest neighbors, and you get this kind of structure in which you can see that you can have either a small clustering coefficient, or in that case, you don't have triangles, but if you want triangles, you can impose it and you can do it in one dimension, two dimension, three dimension. So you can build these networks, these are networks, in which you have a high clustering coefficient, if you want, but you don't have, you have a long path length. And this is quite easy to understand. If the larger your circle here, so if you add nodes, you will increase your average distance always if you just use this. So your average distance increase all the while you increase to infinity, it will go to infinity. So you cannot have a short path length in that case, short average path length. Okay, so we will try to propose, we will see the models that have been proposed to make some networks that are more realistic, random networks are more realistic. The first one is the configuration model. So configuration model is just to solve the problem of the degree distribution. And the idea is that we need to generate networks having predetermined degrees or degree distribution, but maximally random otherwise. So basically, I don't remember if I have a slide later, but the point is that we observed a real network, we compute the properties, and we want to know if it comes from if you have the same property in a randomized version of the network. So the randomized version of the network means I keep all the nodes and I keep the degree of each node, so I want to keep the degree distribution, and then I just shuffle the edges. I want to randomize who is connected to whom, but I want to keep the properties of the node. So you can do it based on an observed network. So you really take your network, you take the degree of each node, and then you will generate a network with keeping exactly this degree distribution. Or if you're just interested in the overall properties, well, you can first generate your sequence of numbers, which will correspond to the degree of the nodes. And then you give this as input to the configuration model and you say, generate a network that has this degree distribution. And you can use the degree distribution that you want, actually. The only global condition is that you should have a number of, or the sum of all the degrees should be pair. Otherwise, you will have some node that has an outgoing edge that cannot be connected to an incoming edge. So you cannot generate this network. And also the largest, if you want a simple graph, you need that your larger degree is smaller than the number of nodes in the network. But anyway, there are two main versions of the configuration model, one which is approximate and one which is exact, so the Chung-Lu and the Molloy-Reed. And we will introduce them quickly. So the Chung-Lu model is the first one, which is approximate degree distribution. It's a coin flipping process for each pair of nodes. So the idea is that you for each pair of nodes, you define a probability to have an edge. And for each pair of nodes, you compute, you flip a coin, you generate a random number, and you check if the probability is higher than, and the number you get is higher than the probability. And in that case, you put an edge. If not, you don't put an edge. So the probability that we have to observe an edge is defined like this. So the degree, so between node I and node j, the probability is the degree of I times the degree of j divided by twice the number of edges. So this is quite easy to understand. If you take the y this value, if you take the point of view of node I, so you take the point of view of node I, and the probability that one of its edge will be connected to j, which has a degree kj, is kj divided by 2m. So why? Because this is the number of, so you want to know if you were connected to j. J has, let's say, 10, a degree of 10. And so there are 10 incoming, let's say, edges from this node. So you just count all the incoming edges that exist in the network, which is twice the number of edge because each edge has two endpoints. So you have all these endpoints that exist, and you know that kj comes from this node. So this is why if you take one of your link, you have a probability to connect to it, which is kj divided by 2m. So the number of endpoints it has over all the endpoints in the network. And since you yourself, you have ki endpoints, so for each of your endpoints, you have this probability to connect to j. So this is the probability to have an edge between two nodes. So there is one small problem with that, is that if your degrees are very large, this can be larger than one. So it's not exactly a probability, but it's an approximation of a probability. Actually, it's rather represents the average, the expected number of edges that you should have between these two nodes. So usually we consider that it's not a big deal in real networks because they are sparse. So because they are sparse, they don't have so many edges, the degree are not that large usually, and this goes well. But basically, this value can be higher than one, so it might be a problem, but we consider that usually if it's above one, we consider that it's one and that they are always connected. So to generate a network, you just take each pair of nodes and you connect them with this probability. So because we do it this way, it produces a simple graph. So a graph in which you cannot have several edges between the same nodes, between the same pair of nodes. A simple graph without self loop. Also, you cannot have a loop to yourself. But the degree of the node is equal only in expectation to the originally assigned degree. Since you are flipping coins, if you generate twice the same network and you are expecting that one node should have a degree of 100, well, sometimes it will be exactly 100, sometimes it will be 99, sometimes it will be 102, but approximately you have the degrees that you want. This approach also has a complexity. If you just naively use it to generate network, it has a complexity in n squared, so squared of the number of nodes, because basically you need to do the test for every pair of nodes. So as you know, n squared might be a problem. If you have 1 million nodes, then it's 1 million times 1 million experiments, flipping coins, and it starts to become big. So this is the first approach. And sometimes, very often, it's actually used as just, we don't compute, we don't generate the network, but we just look at the average solution. So we will see that on the class on community detection. We will compare if we observe an edge with the probability that this edge exists according to the configuration model. So sometimes we don't even generate the network, just study the properties of the network that will be generated by such a model. So the second one is really to generate networks. So it's the case where you have a network, you have an observed network, and you want to generate another one with exactly the same degree distribution, and you want to do it fast also maybe. The solution to this is quite simple. If you look at the picture, you have your original network like that. So this is the network in which you have just cut the links in two half. So you know that this node has a degree of 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. This one is 1, 2, 3, 4. So you have this half link that are going outside of the nodes, and you just want to randomly pick them and connect them. And then you generate a network like this. So it will have exactly the right degree sequence because you just keep the half link and you connect them to the other ones. The problem is that if you do it just really randomly, then there is a possibility to select multiple time stubs of the same pair of nodes. So if you don't know that they belong to the same node, you might connect this this half edge to this half edge, and then you have a self loop. And impossible to select the stubs of the same the self link and to select multiple stubs of the same pair of nodes. So I don't see. Yeah, there is an example here. These two nodes. We have connected this one to this one, and then this one to this one. So there are two edges between the same node. So it's not a simple graph anymore. It's not that bad because the density of multi and self links goes to zero as the number of nodes is growing. Because the more, well, in real network, which are sparse, so you don't have that many stubs, half edges going out of each node. So since you don't have that many, when you increase the number of nodes, but you keep approximately the same degree, then the probability to connect to itself or twice to the same, between the same node is decreasing, right? Because you have more and more possibilities, you have more and more nodes to connect. So this probability will be decreasing. So you might say, yeah, but we could just generate this, make this randomness, this random process, but impose that we don't want this self loop and we don't want to connect twice. So yes, this could be done. But the problem is that first, is that you will need to design an algorithm doing that. And sometimes you get stuck because maybe at the end, you just have pairs of nodes between the same, you just have for the last one, two stubs that belong to the same node. So what do you do? Do you connect them? So if you don't want to connect them, you need to disconnect another one, and then you need to write a complex algorithm. While the advantage of the Molloy-Reed model is that it has a very simple solution, which is extremely fast to find a randomized version of the network. This solution, if you look at the picture here, is as follows. You will write a list of all the with one number which corresponds to each stub, to each half edge, and the number here is the ID of the node. So each number corresponds to one outgoing edge here. You write them, and so for this one has 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 stubs. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 numbers, one, and one corresponds to this node. Then this node has 4, so you put 4 times 2, and so on and so forth. So you have the list of all your half edges. And then you just shuffle that. You shuffle, so you get here a shuffle version. And you take them by turn of 2, like this. And this tells you that you should connect 1 and 4. You should connect 1 and 2. You should connect 2 and 3, and so on and so forth. So you see that this is very cheap to do because you just have to shuffle that, and that's it. You have your solution. So there is this problem of this self loops possible, but you consider that it's not a problem if your graph is large enough. And what people do sometimes is that they just create first this network using this method, and then you remove, if you want, all your self loops and your multiple edges, and you should get a network that still has approximately the same degree distribution as the original one. Okay, so we could do the same thing as we have, as you have seen on Tuesday on the Abel Schwenny, and check the properties of that, but so for this one, so for you have it for the clustering coefficient, and I don't remember here this probability. It should be not independent vanishing quantity. Ah, yeah, because it's okay. So we will maybe first look at the evolution of some property which is interesting for the configuration model, which is the neighbor's degree. So we are interested in in knowing what is the degrees, what is the average degree of the neighbors. And this will be to explain some properties that we have seen on the first class, which is the friendship paradox, that the average degree of your friends are actually larger than yours. And so to do that, we can write the degree distribution for randomly picked neighbor of any node like this. So actually, if you take pk, the fraction of vertices in the network with a degree of k. Okay, so we fix that this is the fraction of vertices with a degree of k. So then the numbers of nodes that have a degree of k is n, so the number of nodes times the probability that a node is of a degree of k. This is the number of nodes that have a degree of k. And then the endpoint of every edge in the network has the same probability of connecting to a particular vertex of degree k. So if you, the same logic as just before for the configuration model, if you want to connect to a node that has a degree k, then the probability that you will connect it to it is just this degree divided by all the half edges. And so the degree distribution of a randomly picked neighbors of a node, so the probability that a neighbor is of degree k is like that. So the probability, the number of nodes that have a degree of k times the probability that for one of those nodes you connected to it. So you get this equation. And if you simplify it, you can see that the average degree of a random picked neighbors, so in that case, you will look for all the possible degrees. So you count for all the possible degrees. What is the degree of it? And what is the number of those edges that are of this degree, and you get this equation, which is here. And if you look at that, you see that you have here the average degree, and here you have the second moment, so we computed as the square every time you have to take the square of the degree of your neighbors. So this has the property that the more the distribution of degree is heterogeneous. So the more you have different values in your degrees, the more you will have something here which is large. If you want to convince yourself of it, you can take an example here in which you have a network with one node of degree 10. And 10 nodes of degree 1, and you have something like this, and you want to come to you wonder what is the average degree of the neighbors in this network, and so the average degree is just taking 10 times 1 and 1 times 10. You take the average of that, and that is your average degree. But now if you look at the average neighbor of the degrees, you have to count what is the average degree of the neighbor of that node. So the average degree of the neighbor of that node is 10, right? Because it has one neighbor and this neighbor has 10 neighbors. So the average degree of the neighbors of this node is 10. This one, it's 10 also. 10, 10, 10, 10, and only this one, all the neighbors, they have a degree of only one. So there, the average degree of that of neighbors of this node is 1. So if you take the average degree of the neighbors of the node, it's 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1 plus 10. It's 10, 10, 10, 10. It's 10 for each of them. 10 for 10, 10, 10, 10, 10, plus 1 divided by 11. So this, you can see that in that case, the average degree of the neighbors is actually pretty close from 10. And yes, so this is when you will take a sum of the value which are squared like that. So that's how you compute the second moment. You will take all the degrees and you will take them at the square. And you see that if you have every time the same value, if all the nodes have the same degree, for instance, all the nodes have a degree of five, then you will have here a sum of five squared every time, and you will divide by five. So if it will end up to have the degree squared divided by the degree. If all the nodes have the same degree, they are all exactly the same degree, then this value, the average degree of the neighbors, will be equal to the average degree. Okay, average degree equals average degree of the neighbors if all the nodes have exactly the same value. And the more differences you have between the degrees, the more this value will increase, and the more you will have. So that's why you will have this Fenchi paradox. So if you have an heterogeneous degree distribution, you have this Fenchi paradox, which tells you that your friends have more friends than you. Okay, so for the configuration model, we can have the degree distribution that we want. The path length, actually, I have not explained it, but it's short, which makes sense because it will actually be quite similar to what happens in a random graph. And the clustering coefficient will remain small because actually it won't change much what happens. You can check the details, but it won't change much what happens with an additionally random graph. So the configuration model is useful to solve this problem of the degree distribution. It really has the same properties as an Erdős-Sweny random graph, but with the degree distribution that you want. But we still haven't solved the clustering coefficient problem. So this was what was observed by Watts and Strogatz in one of the first well-known papers of network science, in which they introduced the notion of small world networks. So the contradiction that we have observed is that real world networks have a high clustering coefficient and short distances. And so they propose a model to explain this in a very simple way. As we have said before, we have seen that in a regular grid network, we have a high clustering coefficient. So they start from a one-dimensional grid in that case, like this. So a network with a given system size, a given number of nodes in the beginning, and a given coordination number, which means the number of neighbors you're connected to. So if you're on a circle like this, on one-dimensional, you have direct neighbors, and you have nodes that are close to you, and you connect to them, so to the k closest from you. And then you just introduce a rewiring probability, which tells you that for each edge in the network, with some probability going from zero to one, you will randomly rewire them. So connect them randomly to between two pairs of nodes taken at random. And so you have the figure here. You start from this regular node. You will randomly rewire some edges until you get to a random network. But you can choose the p that you want between 0 and 1 and get something in the middle. And what they have observed is this phenomenon. It's that here they have plotted according to p between 0 and 1, how the clustering coefficient here and the average path length is evolving. And this is not the raw value, but it's the value they observed with a value of p divided by the value if you keep the value at zero. So of course, that's why here it's one, because you're just dividing C0 divided by C0. So they start at the maximum value. But then what they observed is that when you start to increase p, then your clustering coefficient won't change. And you remember that in the beginning, since we are in a regular grid, we have a high clustering coefficient. And when we start to random wire, the value stay high for quite a long time, for until here 0.01 in this experiment, and then it starts to decrease until, you know, when we arrive at one, we have a random network. So in that case, we have a clustering coefficient, which is vanishing, which is very small. On the contrary, for the average path length, what they observe is that very quickly, as soon as they start to do some random rewiring, this value is decreasing. So you have your average path length, which becomes much shorter, much smaller than before. And so what they observe at this value is what they call the small world regime, in which you have your high clustering coefficient, and you have a small average path length in the network. So the question is probably, is that realistic? So is it what happens in real systems? Is it why real systems have these properties? It's probably not the only solution, clearly. In some cases, it might be an explanation. So for instance, in social network, there is for a long time this notion of the weak links, that actually you have people who are well connected in their community. So you know you are very well connected, so you have a high clustering coefficient with people from your family, from your the people you're going in class with, and so on and so forth. But then if you need to find a job, for instance, so this is well known for the work by Granovetter, if you want to find a job, usually you don't find the job by these people, because these people, they have the same circle as you. They know the same job, they know the same they know the same people. So basically, if they have the information, probably you also have it anyway. So very often, if you want to have access to a job which is very different from in a different city or in a different discipline or something like this, you will need to use your weak links, so connection with people who are outside of your close friends and colleagues. And this is a little bit what we see here. We have this close, nightly connected part of the network, which comes from this original regular organization, the regular grid organization. And then you have these weak links that allow you to move very quickly in the network, that allows you to go to another part, a completely different part of the network, in which there you can go to all the nodes which are around that part. So it's a reasonable model of how society is organized, but it's missing some important points that we will see later. But at least it gives some intuition. So here is the Watt-Strogatz model with this short path length and high clustering coefficient, finally, but it has a degree distribution which is Poissonian. So first, it's lacking at least this point that it still have, but we could modify it to make it more realistic. So this question of the degree distribution is really something that we need to look in more details and discuss. And it was actually introduced as an important point later in the field with this notion of scale-free networks. So a network is called scale-free when it have this, so I already talked about the power law degree distribution. So it's called scale-free when its degree distribution follows a power law degree distribution. So scale-free networks. And a power law distribution is defined like this. So the probability to have, in that case, a node of degree k is proportional. We'll see more details later, that you have a constant for normalization, and then you have this k with an exponent, and this exponent will basically decide the slope so how fast you are decreasing the probability to observe nodes of high degrees. So this notion of scale-free networks, it first appeared in probably in 1999 for networks, when these people, and in particular, you have to remember the last author, Barabasi, because he became the specialist of this notion. He observed that he was looking at the diameter of the World Wide Web. He was plotting this this graph of the world, studying the World Wide Web, and he observed that if you plot the degree distribution of the World Wide Web in log scale, so you have logarithmic scale here and log scale here, then you get something which looks like a straight line. So it was an interesting observation at the time, just in this paper. But it's other ones were interested by this observation, and they started to look at this degree distribution in different networks. And so, for instance, here they took the internet, they have studied the degree distribution, and also they observed that it looks like a line on a log-log plot. So yeah, it becomes interesting. And other researchers have done it on different ones, and they started to observe that, again, you have this line on a log-log plot. So it's quite interesting. So maybe it doesn't work on the whole scale of degrees. They say, okay, maybe we have this line from degree, I don't know, 5 to 10 or 100. But it's a scale degree. So I don't know what are the real values. It's probably much bigger than that. But anyway, so they observe that it's a line on a log-log plot too, until maybe some limit here, because the size of the world is limited. So maybe you cannot have infinite values, so you have to cut it at some point. And again, on some networks, so social networks, they observed again this kind of line. But maybe they say in the beginning it doesn't work because, well, no one has no friends, so you need to have some lower limits. But anyway, you observe at some point this line, so it's interesting. And scientific collaboration, for instance, again, and then people start to say, yeah, maybe it's not a single line, but it should be fitted, could fit with two lines if you look carefully, but I don't know. So is it a line or is it something else? I don't know, a straight line or not. Well, people started to find this everywhere in all the network. They claim that they found this power law. So here it's a more recent paper with many network, from DBLP to DBpedia to Enron email dataset, to I don't remember what is that, Facebook wall post. So you see that you get something that indeed, when you plot it on a log-log scale, it looks often rather straight, rather like a straight line. And you remember the first class, that what this means, it means that you don't have some distribution which is like a bell curve, but you have something which is very unequal. You have a few very large hub, and you have many nodes with a small value. And why do they call it scale-free? You can get an idea intuitive about that. It's just a drawing. It's nothing really meaningful. But if you look at your network from very far away, you will see already that there are some big hubs here, and some smaller parts that are less dense. And if you zoom in, you see that again, this part of this network kind of look a little bit like this one, even though we really changed the scale since you zoom in. You see only this part, but it looks still a little bit similar. And then if you zoom on this part, you get again something that still have this idea of the big hubs, local, which become in that case local hubs. The one that were small here becomes large in that one, and you can continue and so on and so forth until you reach the scale of your system, of course, because yeah, the world is not unlimited. But so that's why it's scale free, because it doesn't have a single scale at which you can study it. You have to, it exists, it has some continuous properties among all different scales. So we can define it more properly, the distribution here, because originally I define it like this, but actually the problem is that you see that, for instance, if you check what it means with a degree of one or zero, you see that you have some problems. So usually we introduce a minimal degree and then we derive it that way. So I won't go into the details because I don't have much time to do it. But what I want to get you is a sense of what's going on. What is special about the power law? So if I plot it like this, I just sample values according to a power law distribution, and I try to plot it on a linear scale from 0 to 10, in that case, so all the values between 0 and 10 with some exponent. So I, as I was saying, you can configure or tune the number of large hubs that you want by changing the exponent. And anyway, here I have plotted with exponent from 2 to 3, which are typical values, and you see that it looks, well, rather similar on that plot. But if I try to plot it on a linear scale with accepting larger value, because here I was only plotting until 10. But now if I plot until 70,000, you see that you don't see anything. You cannot really plot this, you cannot interpret this distribution. You have this just tells you that nearly all the values are very close to zero, and that you still have non-zero values until very large value here. So this is really what it looks like when you try to plot the degree distribution of a very large graph in a linear scale. You get a graph like this and you cannot say anything. So that's why you need to use a log-log plot. So this is the same data, but the same data in a log-log scale. And now you can clearly see that, yes, it looks like a straight line. And you see that your coefficient here, your exponent, is actually controlling the slope of this line on the log-log scale. So one of the problem is it really different with than other distribution? So if I take a Poisson distribution, does it really looks like that different? Can we observe this line? Maybe it could be a Poisson distribution with some parameters. So just to check that, in this example, I plot a power law distribution with my linear scale up to 10 in blue with an average value of 2.5 for the exponent. And then I try to generate Poisson distribution with varying the parameter of the Poisson distribution. And I try to find the one that fits the most. And well, you see, maybe the red one is actually not that far from the blue one if you just look until 10. So maybe you might confuse Poisson for a power law if you just have data from 2 to 10. But if you have data which it's much larger and you have a system large enough so that you can observe maybe nodes with a degree of 100, 1,000, and so on and so forth, then this is the same degree distribution as here, but plotted on this log-log scale. And you see that the Poisson distribution does not look at all as like a straight line, and that you cannot find a Poisson distribution that fits more or less even approximately this kind of distribution that you will observe on a real network. So you see that they are really different. And so what we observed here is called the long tail. The long tail means that you have, often talk about a long tail distribution. Sometimes we are not sure if it's really a power law or not, but it has this property that there are a few nodes with a very large degree. And that's what we call the long tail. This tells you there are, for very large degree, there are still a few nodes. So you can do the same kind of experiment with comparing the power law and the exponential distribution. For instance, you take the exponential and you see that it doesn't look at all like a straight line on this kind of plot. So then we look at what is interesting is to analyze a little bit the moments of the distribution. So the idea is to understand some property about the average and the variance, which makes it very specific. So actually, if you look at these moments and you derive them, what you will observe is that they are not defined in some cases for some value. They will diverge. So I think it's here. So we end up with this observation that the mean of the distribution, so the average degree of a degree distribution, is defined with like this, but it diverges if the exponent is below 2. So it means that if your exponent is below 2, and we will see that 2 and 3 are typical values, if it's below 2, then your mean is diverging. So you cannot really talk about the mean of your degree distribution if it has an exponent which is below 2. And this will be so the second moment. So we will be related to the variance or to standard deviation, and this will diverge for if your exponent is below 3. So actually, yes.
Is there a way to have the mean of the degree for, because for example, in a real complex network, we would have maybe an exponent that would make the mean diverge. That's in real. In the concrete situation, we would have a certain degrees of probability. And is there a way to have this representation of the reality, even though the mean diverges?
Yeah, so actually, it's a good transition to my next slide, in which I will try to explain you what it means that it diverges. Because if I give you a network, you can compute the degrees, you get the list of degrees, so you can compute your mean degree. There is no problem for that. But the question is that this mean degree actually does not correspond to, it's just a specific, if you could generate another time the same network, you will get a different degree. So the value computed depends on the size of the sample. It's not a characteristic of the distribution. So the more node you will observe, so if you have a population of 1 million and you take only half of them, then your average degree will not be the same that if you take the whole population. So basically, it's not really meaningful to interpret it. And why is that? It's because the moments are actually dominated by elements in the long tail. So it means that, you know, when you do some average, you will do your average between the small value and the large value. But here, the thing is that the probability to observe extremely large value is non-zero. And it's actually high enough that if you have the chance to observe one of the very large degree, it will shift your average value to be larger. And so the more elements you observe, the more you will observe a node which is rare, but which has a degree so large that it will shift your average degree it will increase it. And so your average degree is not well-defined because the more node you observe, the more node you will observe that have a gigantic degree and will change your average degree. And this can be actually checked in practice again. So if you look at the moments in that case, so you have a degree distribution, you have your distribution in which the mean is diverging. So you have this exponent which is below 2. And you increase the size of the sample. So you just sample more nodes and you compute every time the mean and the variance. And what you see is that even if you increase the size of this, so when you increase the size of the sample, even to very large value, so you have a large sample, 1,000, 10,000, 100,000, 1 million, and still you see that your mean is increasing. And if you continue to observe new values, your mean will continue to increase. So you're not actually capturing a real property that the mean value of your network or your degrees in that case is I don't know, 5, It's not five. It's just that given the number of nodes that you have observed, it's five. But if you if the network is growing, keeping the same properties, it will be larger than that. And same thing for the variance. You can check the same thing if your exponent is between 2 and 3, then your mean will converge. So it will. So we can compute it given the formula. You can compute that the mean is actually this value. This is the theoretical mean, the dashed line here. And if you measure it, you see that if you have enough observation, you will reach this real mean. But still, you see that it's converging quite slowly. So you need a lot of values to get close to the value that you know by theory that it is the real mean of the distribution. And in that case, you see that the variance is still diverging. And then if you're above 3, so you know that in that case, actually there is a proper value for the variance. It is well defined. But even in that case, you see that still when you get, even after 1 million sample, it's not enough to reach the real variance of the distribution. So this tells you that you need to be careful when you interpret an average value, an average degree, or a distribution or a variance on the good distribution, and you know that it's a power law, then you need to remember that it's probably not the real value, but just some value which depends on the size of your sample. Okay, so how can you know the slope? How can you know the exponent of your distribution? If you observe a distribution, you plot it as a line on a log-log plot. Well, actually, as I said, since the exponent is defines the slope of the line on the log-log plot, then you can just compute this this slope, and it will give you the exponent of your power law distribution. Of course, you can also use some method like the maximum likelihood estimation to do that. And if you want, there are some papers and some libraries that allow you to do that if you need to do it properly. But yeah, it depends on what you are. So I think I have a small slide on that. Why, when is it relevant or not to analyze it? So if you look at real network, so we have seen that we can compute this exponent. And we take this same network as before, and we look at the values of this exponent. And we observe something interesting, that they are actually very often between these 2 and 3. So in some cases, actually it's smaller in these networks, but this is what we will call degenerate cases. We will see later why in intuition of why. But in many of them, you have a value which is between 2 and 3. So why is it that this value is between 2 and 3? Because if the exponent is smaller than 2, then the distribution is so skewed that we expect to find nodes with a degree larger than the size of the network. Okay, so if you have a small exponent, you have a large probability to get nodes with very large degree. And so if it's below 2, then we will say that if we observe 1,000 nodes, 1,000 samples, then with 1,000 samples, you should get one node with a degree 2,000. And obviously that is impossible, because if you have only 100 nodes and you have a sample and you have a simple network, then you cannot have more connection than there are other nodes in the network. So that's why you should, in theory, not be able. So of course, you should not be able to have a distribution with an exponent smaller than 2. It can happen in the example I've shown before because of the limits of the k-min and k-max. So if you set up a minimal degree and a maximal degree, you can actually see a slope more like that. So you have probability to observe large degrees, but it's biased. It's possible due to this limit that you will impose on the maximal degree, for instance, arbitrarily. But usually that explains why you tend not to have degree exponents smaller than 2. And why it's not often larger than 3? It's because in that case, it's the opposite. The probability to observe hubs of very large degree becomes extremely rare. And they become so rare that you have a very little chance to observe them in a real system. So for instance, in that case, we computed, to really be sure that it's a scale-free system, you need to observe enough differences between the degrees. So for instance, you have nodes of degree 1, 2, 3, 4, and then you need to have at least one node of degree 1,000, let's say. So you need to see that it goes from 1 to 1,000. But the probability to observe only one node with a degree of 1,000, if you have, for instance, an exponent of 5, then we see that we need to observe 10 to the power 12 nodes to observe the single node with a degree of 1,000. So the problem is that, of course, Facebook is only 2 billion people. So we are still very far from that. So it will be impossible to observe someone with a degree of 1,000 and an exponent of 5 in a network which has only a few billion nodes. So that's why it's unlikely to observe in the real finite world network with a degree distribution which follows a power law with an exponent which is larger than 3. Okay, so it has also been shown that there is a relation between the exponent of the power law and the distance in the network. So you remember that the average distance in a network, they are short. We have said that. But they are also becoming even shorter when you have some small exponent of the degree distribution. Why? So the simplest way to understand it is to look at the case where you have the smallest possible exponent, 2 in theory. And in that case, the average shortest path is actually a constant and basically 1. Why? Because it means that you have one node which is so large that it's connected to all the others. So the average distance is, well, actually between 1 and 2, because the central node connected to everyone can reach everyone in one hop. And all the other ones, they can reach all the other ones in 2 hops. They just have to go to the hub and then they can go where they want. So if you have a super skewed distribution like this, then everyone can reach everyone in 2 hops, basically. While you see that, and it can be shown actually that it's going faster and faster the more you have a small exponent. So the more chance you have to have big hubs, and the more it will decrease the average distance in the graph. So scale-free are a very popular topic in network science. There are really researchers, specialists on this idea. So I told you before to remember the name of Barabasi. So he's now a very respected scientist which writes a lot of books and which is even famous in the general public, at least in the US and in Hungary, since he's from Hungary. He was the proponent really of that scale-free are something really important in network and that it's something really, really shallow. And recently he basically has this idea that scale-frees are everywhere. And then there is more recently that guy who is more, so he is a physicist and this guy is more a statistician. And he recently wrote a paper called Scale-Free Networks Are Rare. So it was like a frontal attack saying maybe we are wrong and they are not really, these scale-free are actually not really scale-free. And he was arguing something a little bit different. So yeah, this is also a famous researcher in the network science field, and this one is also another famous researcher in the network science field. And so he wrote a paper like Rare and Everywhere: Perspective on Scale-Free Networks, so trying to conceal the two ideas. So basically the point, so this is a big deal because the many research starts from the idea that real networks have a scale-free degree distribution. So if it's not the case, maybe it could have means that some conclusions that have been drawn before are not right. So if I introduce it in that class, I think that it's still mostly true. But let's see what the idea of the discussion is. So what this guy says is that actually, if you use another distribution, which is a log normal distribution, for instance, and you plot it on a log scale, well, you get something. So here, all of them but the blue one are log normal, but with different parameters, and they are not straight lines. But sometimes, if you look at some areas like here, and you just consider it from here to there, then maybe you can say, okay, it looks kind of a straight line, so it should be a power law. Well, actually, it's not a power law, it's something else. There was some clash on Twitter. You know, now science is done on Twitter too. So people they were answering to each other. So you can look at the details and maybe see where is my position if you know how to read a Twitter feed. But anyway, the general idea is that Clausey said that if you do rigorous statistical tests, if you really check if your degree distribution is with the proper test, if it's a power law distribution, then usually you with p-values, your p-values will reject the fact that it's a proper power law. And even if you test which one is the best fit between a power law and the log normal, sometimes you will find that it's not more likely a power law than a log normal. And the objection of Parabasi is that networks are actually real objects from the real world. And so, yes, we know that they are not perfect power law. We know that statistically they are not generated from a random process that generate random value that we know. Of course, on Facebook you have random fluctuation because there are some spammers, there are some people who there are some limits that existed to limit, there are some there are different countries, so maybe it will affect it. So yes, it's not statistically a pure power law, but nevertheless the general idea is that it's still true. It still follows mostly a power law, and power law is a good and simple model of degree distribution. Because why? Because you need a single parameter. You only need your exponent and maybe the minimal and maximal degree. But this is even not mandatory to see your straight line. So with a single parameter, you can explain. You can model what you observe. So it's a good model. And an argument on which I'm not that convinced that there are 20 years of fruitful research based on this model. So that's why this model is good. So maybe I don't agree with that one, but some people agree. But I kind of agree with actually all the other points. And there is even a whole paper on this topic, so dedicated to the controversy, so epidemic clash in network science, where they say that it's really this different vision comes from the different fields which are involved in network science. So physicists usually want to have a good model that can be used to explain the phenomenon, while in other fields, you really want to prove statistically if you're with a robust statistical test, if you follow a hypothesis or not. Yes?
Of course, we saw that a lot of phenomena where the rich get richer and etc. Brings things like power laws. Is it something that was really demonstrated or observed a lot?
Yeah, that's again a good transition with the rest, because actually. One reason why Barabasi is defending a lot this model is that he was proposing the Barabasi-Albert model, which is linked to this rich get richer phenomenon. So I tried to go fast on it, but the idea is that so this was proposed quite a long time ago. I think it's a 99 paper. So it was one of the founding paper of network science. And he said that what we have missed with the previous model, like the small world model and the configuration model and so on, is that actually networks are evolving. They are not static, but growing with time. And they have something, they grow in a specific way according to what he called the preferential attachment, which means that the new nodes that are integrated in the network, that join the network, they don't join randomly, but they join with probabilities, they attach themselves according to some properties of the node. And so he proposed this very simple model in which you start with a simple network with a few nodes and a few edge. It's not that important. You just take a few nodes and a few edge. And then you add nodes one by one or several by several, but it's not that important. But what is important is you connect them with a probability which depends on the previous degree of nodes. So basically, when you add a new node like this one, you will prefer to add, we prefer to connect to the nodes that were already central, already important. So that's this rich get richer phenomenon. You just start to use Spotify. What will you listen to? Well, you will check what probably Spotify will recommend to you, what is the most listened by people. So you will start to listen what everyone is listening. On Netflix, you will start to watch what is in the list of the most recommended, and they are the most recommended because many people watch them. So when you join Twitter, you will probably start to follow the most famous people on Twitter, and so on and so forth. And so this probability, what he proposed is just to connect them with a probability which is so just proportional to the degree of the node. And if you do that, just these simple ideas make emerge naturally a Poirot distribution with an exponent, a degree exponent equals to 3. So it's like the magical number 3. And it's independent from how you configure your initial network. So it's really a property which emerge from this simple phenomenon. And so that's actually one of the key elements of the discussion is that in some aspects, when you say, I have a Poirot distribution in my network, you have to position yourself between, I say this because I think that this is true. So I have a Poirot distribution because I think that my network is following this process. And because I observe this distribution, it's because probably my network has been done with this process. If I just observe a distribution which is very heterogeneous, but I don't really care about how my network was created, maybe I don't really need to argue that I have exactly a Poirot. Maybe I can just say that I have a long tail, and that's it. So yeah, so when Barabasi says that Poirot laws are everywhere, he probably thinks that this model explains at least some elements of the organization of network in general. So that's why. So now we have this other model, the scale-free, the Barabasi-Albert scale-free network with degree distribution which follows the Poirot law. It has also a short path length. This can be shown, but the clustering coefficient is small. So this means that probably this scale-free network, again, it explains something, but it does not explain the real properties of real network because you don't have this clustering coefficient. So we have seen these last two models. We see that they are different, kind of a different idea from the Androsheny random graph. They are here to show that some properties of real network can emerge from simple phenomenon. And that's why we observe this kind of phenomenons in all kinds of real networks, from social network to organization of the brain and so on and so forth. So just to finish quickly, some other random models have been proposed, of course, because you see that there is no green everywhere. So some people wanted to have the green everywhere. And don't have much time also on that, I will go fast, but just an example is the vertex copying model. So basically it looks like the Barabasi one, but instead of connecting randomly to all the existing nodes in the network according to their degree, you will copy one node. So you will take one, you say, maybe if I join, I don't know, Facebook, I will join by a friend. So maybe I will come by this friend and thus I will connect a little bit like that person. That's the general idea. And this will allow to have both the degree distribution and the clustering coefficient. And another one, Holmkim model, which is also, so I don't even remember this one. I did not look it. This one is to make a realistic clustering coefficient, which is more realistic. But you can look at it if you're interested. So you have these models which are able to reproduce the degree distribution, the path length, the short path length, and the clustering coefficient. But the problem is what to do with them. So you have to remember the saying that all models are wrong, but some are useful. So is it useful? So yes, I think these two papers we have seen, the Barabasi and the Small World, they were very useful to show that this phenomenon could emerge, this observation, these properties of networks could emerge from simple phenomenon. But you don't have to take them as a real explanation of how all real networks have emerged. They are kind of networks to make a point. And correlation is not causation. So these simple processes are the cause of what you observe, maybe sometimes, but not always. There are networks which do not have these components and that still have these properties. So it's still open to discussion. And I think I removed the slide, but I wanted also to say why these other models are not that well known. It's because they are quite complex themselves. So if you have a model which is quite complex and you don't really know why you propose this idea, it's not based on some observation that in reality it happens like that. So if you just want to propose a complex, very complex mechanism that generates network with these properties, then it's not that maybe useful because you're not making any point. You're just making the point that yes, these simple rules can generate all of this, but is it working like that in reality? I don't know. Okay, so I have finished this class. I don't know if you have questions. Yes?
Is there a method that, for example, works like a transfer learning? I mean, at first we have a network and then we perform some random actions on that network, and then you say that okay, now it's a simple model that will use some of the properties.
Yes, so this was the case for the second version of the configuration model. You remember, for the second version of the configuration model, you take a real network and then you kind of shuffle it to keep exactly the same degree distribution. But so you start from a real network. For the other ones, they are, as I said, these ones are more to make a point. So the point is, so you don't start with a real network. But then, yes, there exists some version. The problem is always your idea is how to shuffle a network to keep some properties, how to randomize it. But the problem is that it has been shown in several cases that the way you do it will impact the result. Because if you want, for instance, let's say to randomize a network and to keep its original clustering coefficient, the problem is that you need to devise an algorithm to do that, but actually the order in which you will take the edges to randomize them, since you're constrained by the rest of the graph, then the algorithm you will use to do this shuffling will change the result. And so you are not certain that what you observe is a randomized version of your network. Well, it's a randomized version of your network, but whose properties are defined by the process you have used. So that's kind of the problem. That's why it's often better to use these kind of models in which you just flip a coin for each pair of nodes, and then you're pretty certain that you're not impacted by the way you're doing it. Yes?
For example, we have some graph generation, deep graph generation models. For example, we have for example, we have near equal graph, so maybe we can pick the decoder part and generate some graphs, or I guess we have some GAN for the graphs. Do they work for these networks? I mean, do they generate good graphs for these networks?
So good graph for these networks, I'm not sure about this part, but yes, so what you mean is there are some tools. So this, what you talk about is machine learning based process in which, for instance, you will embed your nodes into a low dimensional space, keeping some properties, and then you can regenerate a new network that will kind of keep these properties. So this exists, but yeah, maybe it's beyond the scope of that class, but we will see it if you follow the part in January. I will talk about a little bit about things like that. But yeah, recently there are a lot of work on this kind of generating new network. There are many other ways to generate network with some properties of the original graph. But yeah, it's just scratching the surface here, obviously. There is a strong literature on it. Okay, so you can, for the last part, try to go to the experiments I proposed. So the idea is to do just this part. I have a going further section always, but the going further section is if you're interested to go further. Otherwise, the idea here is just to make you generate some random graph and look at their properties. So only that.